Today I want to talk to you about the Lord Jesus Christ, of course, under the heading of the Righteous One. Now some of you might think that's a very unusual title for me to bring to an Easter message, but actually it's really not. In the New Testament, when Peter delivered his sermon in Acts chapter 3, he called the Lord Jesus Christ the Righteous One. In Acts chapter 7, when Stephen gave that remarkable, incredible sermon right before they stoned him to death, he also called Jesus the Righteous One. And Paul, when he gave his testimony in Acts chapter 22, before the authorities, he again referred to Jesus Christ as the Righteous One. Now the question is, where do they get this title? And the answer is, they get it from the book of Isaiah. And they get it from the very passage we're going to look at today. Now, you guys know me fairly well. Most of you do anyway. You know I like to be a little bit different. And I certainly don't want to ever bore you. So I try and come up with new ways of doing things. And I really wanted to really look at a passage that I have never preached on today. This is the first time I've ever preached on it. But I have studied it for 25 years. Okay, I've heard hundreds of messages on it. I studied it in Bible school. My Bible school lecturers made the mistake of giving me all my assignments and all my books before term started. And by the first 2 weeks in the term, I'd read all the books and finished all the assignments. So I had nothing left to do in the evenings except listen to the football. So I told my lecturers I need something to do. And they said, well, choose something. So I chose W.E. Vine's book on Isaiah in the Old Testament, as he looked at it through the original language, and I greatly benefited from that work, and I spent that entire term in the book of Isaiah. But to this day, I have never preached on it. I've referenced it, I've quoted it, just as many of you have quoted it over the years, but I have never actually preached from it. So it was my great joy to discover that while I was actually studying it a few weeks ago, they came up to me and said, we need somebody to do the Easter message. Will you do it? And I said, well, sure, I would love to. It gives me an opportunity to speak on what? Isaiah 53, which really to me is one of the greatest passages in the entire Bible. Now, anyone who takes the time to read the Bible will discover that Jesus Christ is the dominating theme of the entire book. In the Old Testament, we learn about him prophetically, as his coming is promised, and great detail is given to us about who he would be when he came. In the Gospels, we see him historically, and in the Epistles, we learn about him theologically, as Paul and Peter and John and James and Jude and Luke expound to us even more deeply what Jesus said, what Jesus did, and what the implications are of those things in our daily lives. Then in the book of Revelation, the word revelation means the unveiling. And we have the unveiling of Jesus Christ. And we see him in all his glory and splendor as he comes back, not as the suffering servant, but as King of Kings and Lord of Lords to rule and reign on the earth. So this is a fourfold perspective on Jesus throughout the entire Bible. And many of us have looked at him historically in the Gospels. We've just finished John, okay? And we've looked at him historically. We tend to look at him theologically quite often, don't we? Those of you who have attended any kind of training or book studies have looked at Jesus theologically and understood what the implication is in your life. Maybe not all of you have done Revelation. Maybe we can get something going later on next year, maybe, and actually do an overview of that. I know people are asking for it, and I do have an overview that I would like to do with you sometime. But Revelation, of course, you might not be too familiar, but I'm sure you've looked at it. But actually, most Christians are pretty ignorant about the Old Testament and about what it has to say about Jesus. So let me introduce you to the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah is a Bible all by itself. Did you know that? It is actually a Bible all by itself. Let me prove it to you. Isaiah has 66 chapters, and the Bible has 66 books, right? You might say, well, it's not that impressive. Okay, well, let's move on to the next point. There are two major sections in Isaiah, chapters 1 to 39 and chapters 40 to 66. That means there are 39 chapters in the first section and 27 in the second, just like the Bible. 39 in the Old Testament, 27 in the New. Chapters 1 to 39 in Isaiah speak about judgment upon sin. both judgment that would be immediate, judgment that would be future, and then judgment that would be ultimate when God would send the day of the Lord and deal judgment upon the entire earth. And the Old Testament, of course, does the same thing. It tells us about the problem of sin and the fact that God must judge sin because he is a holy God and we have broken his law. Then in chapters 40 to 66, which is the second section, the theme in Isaiah is grace and salvation through the coming Messiah. And of course, in the New Testament, the theme is grace and salvation through Jesus Christ. But don't worry, it gets more exciting than that. In Isaiah 40, which is the beginning of the second section, or the New Testament section, it begins with John the Baptist. And it continues with a prophecy about the coming of Jesus Christ. Now, of course, in the New Testament, it's the same, isn't it? The New Testament kicks off the story with John the Baptist and then the birth of Jesus Christ, which came 3 months later. They were cousins, remember? Their families knew each other. And then, as if that was not enough, Isaiah ends with a new heaven and a new earth. And so does the New Testament end with a new heaven and a new earth. Isn't that exciting? How you've got an entire Bible within a Bible? So Isaiah is a book you need to look at, but I'm not done yet, okay? We still got more, okay? The Isaiah has four songs about the Messiah, four songs. And the New Testament has four Gospels. The first song is found in Isaiah 42, and it presents the Messiah as a king, a just, righteous king who will come back to rule. Matthew's Gospel presents Jesus as king. Isaiah 49 is the second song. It presents Messiah as the servant. And of course, Mark presented Jesus as the servant. In Isaiah 50, we have Messiah the man. And we see his humanity very clearly talked about. And then in Luke, of course, we have his humanity as well. And then finally, in our passage for today, Isaiah 52:13 through to 53:12, we have Messiah the righteous one. And it presents him as the God-man. And of course, John presents his deity. Isaiah, what does it mean? The salvation of the Lord. Isn't that what the Bible is all about? The salvation of the Lord. So this is amazing, isn't it? And I'm not finished yet. We still got more, okay? But I don't want to give you too many details, but let's at least think about this. Augustine said it's not a prophecy, it is a gospel. And that's really true. You will find everything you need to know about the gospel in the book of Isaiah. Everything. Every truth that we have in the gospels, everything that we truly understand about what it means to become a Christian is found in the book of Isaiah. In fact, it's often referred to as the fifth gospel. Or if you like to be different, like John MacArthur, the first gospel. Okay? But of course he's right. It did come first, right? 700 years before Jesus came into the world, Isaiah wrote this prophecy. Now, that's pretty incredible when you think about it, because the details I'm going to show you are going to blow you away. Okay? Now, there's a lot of cults out there that claim to have prophecies, right? You got people in the malls that will look at your hand and tell you your future. I always like to sit down with them and tell them, I want to tell you your future, okay? Because I know their future. I know they're going to hell if they don't repent. So I tell them that. But of course, what they're doing is a sham. They don't really have any power. And anything they do know is given to them by demons, not by God. So we know for sure that they're charlatans, but the Bible is specific and it gives details that cannot be ignored. Even names in places are given of different people and different events that will happen. It cannot be ignored. And of course, this book, Isaiah, contains a great deal of information about Jesus Christ. Just like John's gospel, the fourth servant song also contains a detailed passion narrative. Now, those of you who studied John with us last year and at the beginning of this year, well, you know that the passion narrative is a huge part of John's gospel, right? An enormous part. In fact, from chapter 12 onwards, right to the end of John's gospel, you've pretty much got the final evening in Jesus' life, and then his death, and then his resurrection. So an enormous part of John's gospel centers around the events that took place on the very week that we're celebrating now, what we call Easter. Polycarp, who was discipled by John the Apostle, okay, calls Isaiah 53 the golden passional of the Old Testament evangelists. Isn't that remarkable? Even he recognizes the connection between Isaiah and John's preaching. So, it starts, though, this passage, and it ends with God's perspective on the cross. And that's important, right? Because the bottom line is, you're not really come here this morning to hear my perspective. You're not really interested in what other people have to say. What we care about is, what does God say? What is God's opinion about the cross? What does God have to say about it? And this passage starts and begins with God speaking. And then in the middle, we have the nation of Israel in the future speaking. Okay? Very interesting. Now, what am I always telling you in Bible study? Those of you who have been my GLC students will know I talk about this all the time. Grammar matters. God has chosen to give us his word in language. And it's important that we understand grammar. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to get too technical, but I just want you to understand something very simple about our passage this morning. Firstly, in the first section, the pronouns are singular, all right? And the tense is future. God is looking 700 years into the future to the time that Jesus came and died on the cross, all right? That's not too hard to understand, is it? God is looking forward to the cross. In the second section, the pronouns change and they become plural. And the verbs become past tense. And what we have there is Israel looking back in repentance to the cross. Now that hasn't happened yet, has it? That's still in the future for us. Revelation talks about it. In the book of Revelation, that's what the tribulation is for. God brings a 7-year tribulation on the earth. It's called in Daniel the time of Jacob's trouble. That's Israel's trouble. And it will be brought upon the earth. It's the missing week in Daniel chapter 9 for those Bible scholars among you. Okay? And God will bring this time of trouble, this 7-year period, upon the world. And it is designed to bring Israel to repentance. Amazing. I'll tell you more about that in a minute. And then at the end of the passage, the pronouns switch back to singular again. The tense becomes future again, as God looks forward to the cross and explains it to us and tells us what it means. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that remarkable? So in this one, we're looking at something that has happened already for us, but is still yet to happen in the future for Israel. How can I back this up? Very easily. Zechariah talks about it a lot. He says, there's coming a day when I will pour out on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem, that's Israel, the spirit of grace and of supplication, so that they will look on me whom they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only son. And they will weep bitterly over him like the bitter weeping over a firstborn son. The implication being the firstborn son has died, okay? Now, what is he saying here? Notice that he is both me and him at the same time. How can you be me and him at the same time? Easy, if you are both God and man, right? But it's a bit of a challenge if you're just a man. Can't be done. But if you are both God and man, you can both be the one that they look on, and you can also be the one they are mourning for. Incredible, isn't it? In Zechariah 13, it says that a fountain will be opened for the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and impurity. There is coming a day when God will cleanse Israel's sin. Amazing. And in Zechariah 14, it says the Lord will set up his kingdom and the Lord will be king over all the earth. Now that is promised all throughout the Old Testament, okay? It's very important. In 1985, Steven Spielberg took us back to the future. Do you remember that? I was there. I watched it in the cinema. I was a teenager then. Shows how old I am. Okay. And I watched it. I saw it. And I enjoyed it. And I still do. It's a good film, right? But Isaiah does one better. Isaiah takes us ahead to the past. See if you can figure that one out. You might need your lunch first, okay? But what's happening? We are going ahead to a time that hasn't even happened yet, when Israel will bow their knees in repentance, looking back to what is already past for us, what happened 2,000 years ago at the cross. Now, why is this important to us? Okay, that's Israel, right? Why is that important to us? Because this passage is also the confession of every person that will ever escape eternal hell and enter heaven. If you are saved this morning, if you are a Christian, then this is your confession. And you will be amazed how many of these verses you know. Pretty much almost every single line in our passage is quoted in the New Testament. It's quoted 50 times. And most Christians have their own language, right? We speak what we call Christianese. And it's very confusing to new people. So if you're new, please forgive us if we speak some words sometimes you don't understand. We'll try and explain them. But the reason we have this strange language as Christians is because we read the Bible. And because God gives us a lot of information in there, and God has told us about the future, and God has told us about the past, and the terminology we use sometimes is a little confusing to people who are new. But let me help you to understand something. Why is this important? It's important because there is a question that has to be answered. It is the question above all questions. There is no question like this. It is the ultimate question. What is it? Do you think you know? Let's read it. How can a holy and just God forgive sinners that deserve hell, declare them righteous or right with him, and allow them to enter heaven and still remain holy and just? How can God do that? That's the question. That's the question of all questions. There is no greater question. Job asked that question back in the book of Job in a different way, but he asked the same question. Paul asked that question in Romans chapter 3, where he says, you know, basically, how can God be a justifier and just at the same time? Well, this passage is going to answer that question for all of us today. Now, I tend to get my headings from the text, okay? I'm not very creative, I'll be honest with you. I'm not very good at coming up with hard-hitting outlines. I often steal them from other people. But that's okay. That's what preachers do. We read a good book. Oh, that's really cool. I'll use that, you know. That's okay. No problem. Because they did the same thing and the people before them did the same thing. And ultimately, it all goes back to the Bible, right? And what Jesus said. So that's okay. But I like to pull my headings directly from the text, okay? So let me give you one, the first one. His suffering was astonishing. Astonishing. Now, if you're looking at your Bible and you're saying, why are we starting in verse 13 of chapter 52? That's a good question, right? The answer is very simple. The verse divisions and the chapter divisions were not added until the 1500s. Back in the early days, back in Jesus' time, people used to memorize the text, okay? So the preacher could open the scroll and roll it out, and everybody would be on the same page because the Jewish leaders used to memorize the scriptures, and so did the people. But today, people tend not to memorize the Bible. It is a very big book, right? And quite hard to remember. So the translators thought they would be helpful, and they gave us chapter and verse divisions. And most of the time, that's helpful. In this case, not really, because they put it in the wrong place. Okay? They should have put it at where verse 13 comes in chapter 52, because that's the beginning of God talking about his servant, the servant song. But they moved it a couple of verses down. And my personal opinion is, and it comes down to personal opinion because it's not inspired by God, but my personal opinion is it would have been better if they'd moved that 53 up a couple of verses, okay? So I'll let you decide what you think. But essentially, that's why we're starting at verse 13 of chapter 52 instead of verse 1 of chapter 53, because that's where it begins. And God opens up the psalm by revealing two remarkable and stunning facts about the Messiah right in the very first stanza. Now, what do I mean by stanza? This is a song. This is a song that Israel will sing in the future. It's a lament. It's a song of mourning. It's a song of repentance. As they look back to the time of Christ and they sit there with their head in their hands and they say, how could we have been so stupid? We killed our Messiah. We despised the very one who died for us. And in this passage, we're going to be introduced to something that people seem to not understand very well today. We're going to be introduced to real repentance. What is real repentance? What does it look like? Well, we're going to see. In the first verse, it says, behold, my servant. Ebed in the Greek, it means slave, my slave. Why was he a slave? Why is Jesus a slave? Because he didn't come to do his own will, did he? He says, I do the will of my Father. In Gethsemane, what did he pray? Not my will, but yours be done. And that's why the Bible refers to him as a servant or a slave, okay? my servant will prosper. He will be high and lifted up and greatly exalted. What does this mean? Well, actually, it's three words that speak about the same thing. He will be high, he will be higher, and he will be highest. That's what it means. Now, where else do we find this language in the Bible? Isaiah chapter 6, where it talks about Isaiah's vision of God. That's the only other place you find this terminology. This terminology is used of God. So right here in the first verse, we find that this Messiah would be a slave. He'd be a man, a slave. But he would also be what? God. Amazing, isn't it? I wish I had time to take you back to Isaiah, but the clock is really defeating me already and I need to get going. But I need you to understand this. Right here in the very beginning, it presents him as the God-man. Incredible, isn't it? And it talks about his exaltation. He will be high, he will be higher, he will be the highest. Now, how can you be the highest and not be God? Who is the highest? God. There is no one higher than God. He is the highest. That's what the word highest means. He's exalted. But it goes on in verse 14 to say, just as many were astonished at you, ignore the my people bit. Another word for those of you who are new. When the Bible puts words in italics, okay, those are words added by the translators to complete the meaning. But sometimes I don't think it helps, okay? Other times it does, other times it doesn't. And when you're translating from one language to another, you need to add words, right, in order to make it make sense. If you go from Tagalog to English, okay, it doesn't really work if you just follow it word for word. You'll know if you ever try and explain a Tagalog joke to me. I'm going to sit there looking at you like this. That's not funny, okay? That's what happens in our family all the time. They're laughing away, and I say, why is it funny? And my wife says, well, if I translate it, it's not funny anymore. And that's the way it works. And in the Bible, we're translating from Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek into English. So the translators do have to put a few words in there to help with the meaning. In this case, it doesn't really help because it's not talking about his people. It's talking about him. Just as many were astonished at you, so his appearance was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. Some people have interpreted that to mean he was ugly. I don't believe he was ugly. We're talking about a perfect man, okay? He was a perfect man. He never had a sinful nature. His body was not affected by sin in any way. I don't believe Jesus was ugly. I think he was a very handsome man, as men were meant to be. What this is referring to is his humiliation. Okay? And right at the start, God sets the scene. He says, my servant, who is also my son, God, will be exalted. But before he is exalted, he must first be what? Humiliated. The cross before the crown. And we'll see this as we go along. Thus he will sprinkle, I don't think so, not a very good translation, okay? Sprinkle, the Hebrew word can mean to spurt. So some people have interpreted it sprinkle, but actually a better translation is startle, okay? And you can turn to, for those of you theologians here, you can turn to Thea and look at Thea, and Thea will tell you why, all right? It actually refers metaphorically to leaping up in surprise. They will be startled. Many nations, and of course that's borne out by the context because it says kings will shut their mouths on account of him, for what had not been told them they will see. And what they had not heard, they will understand. So here we have a situation where he is exalted. But first he had to be humiliated. And then later on he will be what? Exalted again. Now, what does that remind you of? Okay? I don't really have to spell it out, do I? It sounds very much like Jesus, doesn't it? Who was God? Who took on human flesh, it says in John chapter 1, and became a man, who was humiliated and then was exalted back to the right hand of God and took his rightful place again. And who will one day come, who will set up his kingdom on the earth, and all the kings of the earth will what? They will shut their mouths, or they will confess him as Lord. Amazing, isn't it? Isaiah explains it all. But not only was it astonishing, not only was this really surprising, but it was also offensive. Offensive. It's still offensive to people today. When you tell somebody who is from another religion or lives in another place, it's harder with Filipinos because you guys are kind of Christianized as a nation, and most Filipinos are familiar with the cross and what happened. But if you go to another religion and tell them that their Savior is a crucified criminal, a Jew, and that he died for their sins, they're going to look at you and go, are you joking or what? That's offensive. It's a stumbling block, Paul says in the New Testament. And in stanza 2 of the song, the language changes. Okay, this is not God speaking anymore. This is now Israel speaking. And we have the future repentance and confession of Israel as they mourn over their rejection of him the first time he came. Let's see what they have to say, shall we? Who has believed our message? Now, in English, you can read that two ways, right? You could say, this is a message that we gave, or this is a message that we possess. Okay? And it's actually the latter here in the Hebrew. Who has believed the message that we have received? Our message. It was given to us, is the correct translation. And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? The arm is the power. Okay? It's a symbol of power in ancient times. The king would put someone at his right hand. That meant he was in a place of power. Okay? So Israel says, who has believed the message we received? No one. We didn't believe it. And even though Christ came and we saw the power of God at work, what did Jesus do? He healed what? Diseases. He cast out demons. And he even raised people from the dead. Did they see God's power at work? Yes. John 11 says, after they watched him raise Lazarus from the dead, the Pharisees plotted to kill him. Isn't that incredible? You watch someone raise someone from the dead, and now you want him dead? That doesn't make sense, does it? But that shows where their heart was. They didn't believe the message, and they certainly didn't believe that he did the miracles by the power of God. In fact, they accused him of working those miracles by the power of who? Satan. Incredible. We heard the message, they said, but we didn't believe it. We saw his miracles, and we still didn't believe it. But why? Why didn't they believe? Well, they tell you. I told you, this is their confession. They're going to tell you why they didn't believe. They say, for he grew up before him like a tender shoot. He, that is Jesus, grew up before him, that is God, like a tender shoot. And like a root out of parched ground, he has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should be attracted to him. He wasn't what we were looking for. Isn't that amazing? He wasn't what we were looking for. He was despised. He was forsaken by men. He was a man of sorrows. He was acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised. And we did not esteem him. What are they trying to say here? It's simple. We despised his birth. When he grew up like a tender shoot, we looked at him. He was poor. He had a humble beginning, right? He was born to a poor young couple. He lived in Nazareth and worked as a carpenter. He was not a wealthy guy. And we despised his birth. Not only that, but we despised his life, the way that he lived. Well, who did he hang out with? Fishermen, shepherds, prostitutes, thieves, tax collectors. Those were Jesus' friends. He led them to himself and he saved them from their sin. Did he hang out with kings? No. Did he hang out with the religious leaders? No. Did he have degrees from the most prestigious universities? No. No, he went to the poor. And he lived among them. The rich didn't want anything to do with him. The educated didn't want to know him. And they despised him for it. He wasn't what they were looking for, was he? And then finally, he died as a criminal, disfigured because of the incredible beating that he took. He didn't even look human anymore. He was beaten within an inch of his life and then killed. And the Jews said, we despised him. We despised his birth, we despised his life, and we despised his death. We despised him. Shocking, isn't it? But this is the truth. Just read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And you will see the truth of this. God had told them Messiah would be born into poverty if they'd just read the prophets. They told them that he would be born in Bethlehem and have a humble beginning. He worked in Nazareth as a carpenter, and they couldn't reconcile who he was and the way he lived with their Messiah. Now, isn't that interesting? Their theology was wrong. And because their theology was wrong, they didn't recognize their Savior. Where have we heard that before? Isn't that like much of the world today? If we were to go out there into the Philippines today, to the malls, to the roads, to the religious places, wouldn't we meet people who have wrong theology? People who think that actually they don't really need a Savior. Why? Because they're good. Because they think they're okay. Because they think they're moral people. Because they think they do a lot of good works. Because of their religious ceremonies. Because they're trusting in other mediators. They don't think they need a Savior. And that's just what the Jews were like. They had their religious ceremonies. They had the temple. They had their alms giving. They had their money giving. And they had their sacrifices. And they had their washings. And they had their baptisms. And they thought that they were fine. And later on, in the years to come, what are they going to say? We didn't listen to the prophets. If only we had listened to the prophets. If only we had paid attention. We wanted a king. We wanted somebody to take care of our enemies. We wanted somebody to make us rich. We wanted somebody to solve all our problems. That's what we wanted. God didn't give us that. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? You ever watch TBN or Daystar on TV? Don't you hear a lot of that preaching today coming out of America and other countries? Jesus wants you to be healthy, wealthy, and happy. Isn't that the message many people are preaching today? Is there truth in that? Absolutely not. It is a lie from the pit of hell. Okay? That is what the Bible calls the doctrine of demons. You can't get saved by that gospel. But that's the kind of gospel people present. They go out there and they tell people from the pulpit on national television, "Do you believe in Jesus? Do you want to go to heaven when you die? Do you want Jesus to fix your marriage?" That's the kind of questions people ask. It's the wrong question. It's the wrong question. God didn't give them what they wanted. God gave them what they needed. What did they need? He gave them a Savior. Someone to save them from their sin. Because that's our biggest problem, folks. Our biggest problem is not our economic status. Even though some of us may be hard up for money and we may not have a lot, that's not our biggest problem. Our biggest problem is not our marriage, okay? Even though our marriage may be strained or tough. That's not our biggest problem. Our biggest problem is we're going to spend eternity in hell if somebody doesn't pay God for our sin. That's what's going to happen. Because the bottom line is the gospel message is simple. Either you pay for your sin, or somebody else pays for it. But somebody's got to pay for it. God is just. He doesn't sweep sin under the rug. Either you pay for your sin, or somebody else pays for your sin. But somebody's got to pay for your sin. Otherwise, you will never go to heaven when you die. Doesn't matter how religious you are. The Jews were more religious than Filipinos by far. Okay? I don't have time to regale you with stories, but I could. Go into all sorts of details about the rules and regulations they followed on a daily basis. It would blow your mind, especially the ladies. Blow your mind, the rules they used to follow. But as religious as they were, none of that counted for anything in God's eyes. Why? Because they despised the sacrifice he provided. They tortured him and then they killed him. And now they're looking back, so many years later, at least 2,000 years. If Jesus comes back tomorrow for his church, then it will be 7 years before they get saved. So it's at least 2,000 years, if not many more. We don't know when Jesus will come back. And they look back across the millennia to the cross, and they repent, and they say, "Why didn't we listen?" In the third stanza of our song, the middle stanza, we come to the heart of the matter. His suffering was substitutionary, Now, I like to throw in that little word at the end, vicarious, because I think you need to learn new words sometimes, okay? Vicarious is very commonly used. If you read Christian books of any caliber, that is, not the popular paperbacks, but the real Christian books that really teach you the truth, you will come across this word often. Vicarious simply means to suffer in the place of another person. And we learn that the suffering of this servant was vicarious. It was substitutionary. He died in their place. And of course, our place too. In the middle stanza of the song, Israel recognized that Jesus Christ died for their sins. And what they have to say about it is remarkable. In genuine repentance, they confess they thought God was punishing him for blasphemy. Do you realize that's what they thought? I know many of you probably don't read the Talmud, okay? But in the Talmud, which is the Jewish law, what it actually says there is that their story, because after Jesus rose from the dead, they had to come up with a story, right? They've got an empty tomb, no Jesus, and his disciples are turning the world upside down, telling everybody he rose from the dead. And they had to come up with a story. Do you know what they came up with? It's very simple. They said that there was a hairdresser in Israel called Miriam Ben-Stata. And she was an evil woman, not a nice woman like Mary in the Bible. And they basically called her Miriam instead of Mary. And they say that she fell in love with a Roman mercenary called Joseph. And they had an illicit affair and ended up getting together. And Jesus was the product of their union. They don't call him Yeshua or Jesus. They call him Yeshu, which is a very derogatory term. And they taught that he went down into Egypt and he learned the black arts of magic. And he learned how to deceive men. And then he came back to Israel and he claimed to be God. What did they think he was being punished for? Blasphemy. That was always their accusation, right? When Jesus said the Father and I are one in John 10, what did they say? We're going to kill him. They picked up stones. They wanted to put him to death. Jesus said, for which of my works, which of my miracles are you going to kill me? And they said, we're not killing you because of your miracles. We like your miracles. We're going to kill you because you make yourself out to be God. Jesus claimed to be God. You can't overlook that. So they thought when he died on the cross that God allowed it because he was a blasphemer. Because he was a Satanist, if you like. That's what they accused him of. You can read the Talmud today. Do you know why it's so difficult to witness to Jews today? Because this is what they're raised on. Jews are taught this from a young age. That this is who Jesus was. Complete lie. A complete fabrication. Yet they believe it. Many do anyway. This is why Jews hate Jesus so much. You can talk to Jews about a lot of things. Go and talk to them about the Old Testament. Go and talk to them about the prophets. They'll happily talk with you. You can ask them to teach you Hebrew and they'll happily comply. But when you get into a conversation about Jesus, the rabbis will throw you out. They hate him. They despise him. But here, a future generation of Israel will confess that they are sinners and that he died for their sin. Let's read it. Surely our griefs, they say, he himself bore. Our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him what? Stricken. We thought he was smitten of God and afflicted. We got it so wrong. And you want to know? That's our first clue of true repentance. Where does true repentance begin? With a recognition that you think wrong. The Bible tells us we are blinded. The Bible tells us we're ignorant. The Bible tells us we don't see things the same way God does. And for true repentance to take place, there has to come a recognition that we are thinking wrong. And we have to allow God, through his word, to straighten our thinking out. That's what repentance is, right? It means to change your mind. That's what the word, the root word means. And literally what that means is that we used to believe one thing, and then we heard God's word, and we immediately believed it. And we changed our thinking, and our mind changed, and we embraced the teaching in the Bible about Jesus Christ. That's where repentance begins, on the fact that we think wrong. There came a time in my life where I admitted, I thought wrong. It was not the way I thought. But now my eyes are open and I can see. It's amazing. It goes on to say, but he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him. The plural pronouns flowing out everywhere, right? Our. This is us, Israel says. We were the ones. He suffered for us. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging, we are healed. And what do we learn here about transgressions, about iniquities? We learn that we act wrong too. We don't just think wrong. We act wrong. We do the wrong thing. We sin. But it doesn't stop there. And in verse 6, we come to a very famous verse that I'm sure many of you know off by heart. And you've heard many, many times. Many preachers have quoted it. You may have read it in many books. Some of you may have learned it in Sunday school. All we vest like sheep. I almost said the King James then because I learned it in King James. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. What is this saying? We don't just think wrong. We don't just act wrong. We are wrong. At our very nature, we are wrong. How many of you know anything about sheep? I know you don't have many sheep. What is it, tupa in the Philippines? I know you don't have many sheep in the Philippines, okay? But how many of you know about them? In England, we have a lot of sheep. A lot of sheep. They're everywhere. I remember going on holiday with my wife. I had amoeba at the time, and my nieces were in the car, and we saw this sheep hanging with its feet dangling in midair between the roadway and the fence. It had gotten out of the field. It had wandered up this steep road, and it had fallen and wedged between the fence. And being dumb like a sheep, its legs are still going like this, but it's not going anywhere. It's just kind of stuck, suspended in midair. And of course, the nieces and my wife, oh, you know, poor Kawawa, you know, the poor sheep is so Kawawa, you've got to help it. Now, don't worry that I'm suffering with amoeba and all I want is to get to the bathroom, okay? So I had to get out of the car, I had to climb down between the fence and the road, and I had to pick up this dirty, filthy, smelly sheep. And I had to carry him back down the road to the fence and then put him safely over the fence before the ladies were happy, okay? And you learn a lot about sheep when you are around them. They are the dumbest creatures on earth. I mean, honestly, they really are. They're not nasty creatures. They're just dumb creatures. They wander all over the place, constantly. They're always getting in trouble. They're falling into bogs, falling off cliffs, falling into rivers. They just sit there and look at the wolves like this while the wolves think about eating them. I mean, they are just so dumb. And there's a reason why God chose sheep as an illustration for us. Okay? Because even though we know sin hurts us, we still do it, right? We know the consequences. We know that the wages of sin is what? Death. And yet we still sin. Why? Those of you who have children should know why. How many of you had classes for your children teaching them how to disobey you? Did you do that? Did you teach them how to say no? Did you have classes for your children teaching them how to steal? Okay? You didn't do that, did you? We have to teach them how to do what is right. Because from the womb they know how to do what is wrong. Because we're all born with a sinful nature. That's what the Bible teaches. We inherited it from Adam. Now, this is something you got to understand. I don't want this to turn into a doctrine class this morning, but you need to understand this is the very basics. We are like sheep. We have gone astray. And at our very nature, at the very deepest level of our being, we are wrong. We are sinners. And we are separated from God. And we have to understand that. And this is what Israel is confessing. They said, we didn't just think wrong. We didn't just act wrong. We are by nature wrong. And we need a Savior. And that's why he came. And this is the incredible truth. He was pierced. That word means a violent death. It is the most or the strongest word in Hebrew for a violent death. He was pierced. He was crushed, battered, bruised to death, bloodied. He was chastened. That means punished. That's why we often refer to us what he did on the cross for us as penal. Okay? As in the penal system where people get thrown into prison and punished. Okay? What he did for us was penal. He endured our punishment. Penal substitution. That's what he did. Not only that, he was scourged. Lashed, slashed, wounded. Now, if you look at that whip, it looks kind of a little bit innocent, doesn't it? Apart from the metal balls. But they used to put bone. They used to put glass. They used to put strips of metal. And the idea was to sink it as deeply into the flesh on the back as possible so that when you pull it back, it strips the flesh off the back. And that's what they did to Jesus. That was before they crucified him. This is why he was marred beyond appearance. This is why people didn't want to look at him. Because he didn't look human anymore. He had been beaten to a bloody pulp. And he had been done for us because of our sinful nature. Friends, you're not going to hell because you stole a cookie when you were four, okay? That's not why you're going to hell. You're going to hell because you are a sinner by nature. The reason you stole a cookie when you were four is because you were born a sinner. It's not about what you have done. It's about who you are. And that's what salvation is. You are a child of Adam. You are a sinner. You are separated from God. And Jesus came and he died in your place so that you can what? Become a child of God. Salvation is about who you are. Oh, we've sinned. Yes, we've sinned. We're experts. We've practiced our whole lives to be good at it, right? That's why it's so hard when you become a Christian to live God's way because you have so many habits that you developed over so many years. It's not easy. It's a fight. It's a battle to walk with God. Even as a Christian with the indwelling Holy Spirit, it's a fight because we practiced and practiced and practiced having our own way. This is why the Bible calls us sheep. At our very nature, we are sinners. He died for our transgressions. That means our violations. Every time we violated God's law, he paid for that. He died for our iniquities or our perversions. This is how God views our sin. When I was at the True Life retreat this week, and I made a statement. I didn't realize it would come back to me later on. They actually chose to make it into a poster and posted it on Facebook. So now I've got to answer all these messages about people asking about what I said. But what I actually said was, people feel more guilty today about eating too many French fries than they do about offending a holy God with their sin. Okay? Now that is true. It is a true statement. People feel more guilty about what they eat than they do about their immorality, than they do about the terrible sins that they commit in our generation. That is how bad our generation is. See, God looks at our sin. He doesn't just say, oh, that's a white sin. I'll let that go. God looks at our sin and he calls it a perversion. Now, we reserve perversion for the very worst sins, right? Rape, that's a perversion. Murder, that's a perversion. No. God says lying is a perversion. Lying. Happens all the time in the Philippines, doesn't it? And around the world. I walk in a national bookstore and I ask a question and I'm immediately lied to. Do you have this? Yes, sir. But they don't. You know? Can you order it? Yes, sir. But they can't. I'll take your number, sir, and I'll call you. But they don't. Now, I'm using a very simple illustration to show you Jesus died for that. Do you understand that? We don't see sin the way God sees it. We don't. We're hardened. Our hearts are hard. And that's why we need the Holy Spirit to melt them, to turn them into what the Bible calls a heart of flesh again. Because to be honest with you, many of us have a heart of stone. We have lost the sensitivity that we should have towards sin and towards God. But here's the bottom line. In order to receive salvation, you must first recognize that you are a sinner. Not that you have done wrong, but that you are by nature a sinner. and that you need a Savior. Now, is that so hard? You know, for some people, it really is. For some people, it really, really is hard. Deep down inside, they think they're good. Society has programmed them to think they are a victim of circumstance. They're a victim of their economic status. They're a victim of their family. They're a victim of some kind of tragedy. And deep down inside, they think they're justified in acting out the way they do. But the Bible says no. When you stand before a holy God, He will declare you a sinner. And the only thing that's going to save you is if you have Jesus Christ as your Savior. Do you understand that? Good works won't save you. The Bible says no one is good. How does somebody who is not good, how does somebody who is a sinner by nature do a good work? It's impossible. That's why the Bible calls works that you do prior to salvation dead works, not good works. Why are they dead works? Because they were done by people who are spiritually dead. When do good works become important? After salvation. That's when they become important. Because now you're living with God's help. And He enables you to perform good works. Friends, we're sinners. We can't offer God anything good. We just can't. The Bible says there is no one good, not even one. Psalm 14, Romans 3. Friends, you need to learn this. His suffering was also willing. Now, this is important, okay? Nobody killed Jesus. Not in the sense that we think He was taken and killed. I mean, it is true, right, that the Roman soldiers took Him. It is true that it was because of the will of the Jews that He was nailed to a Roman cross. But we're talking about God here. Don't you think He could have crushed them like a bug if He wanted to? Of course He could. God requires death as payment for sin. And for thousands of years, Israel had made sacrifices that dramatized what Jesus would do one day. Do you ever wonder why they had to bring sacrifices in the Old Testament? There were a lot of them, right? Leviticus 1-7, they had five sacrifices they had to bring. Five. A burnt offering, a grain offering, a peace offering, a sin offering, and a guilt offering. And they had to bring them all. Every day they would bring a guilt offering, and we'll see that mentioned in a minute. But here's the thing. They had acted this out for thousands of years. Thousands of years. Century after century, they dramatized Jesus' death. And then when He came, they didn't recognize Him. Incredible, isn't it? Finally, the one true Lamb had come, and they rejected Him. Do you remember what John the Baptist said about Jesus when he saw Him? Do you remember this verse? The next day he saw Jesus coming to him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." What a statement. But that's who the prophet said He would be. He would come as a sacrifice. Before He could be exalted, He had to be humiliated. The cross had to come before the crown. And that's still true for our Christian lives today. We look forward to the crown, don't we? We look forward to the kingdom on earth. We look forward to heaven, where there will be health, wealth, and happiness. We look forward to those days. But we're not there yet. And as Christians, we're called to pick up our cross and follow Him. And the cross is a painful thing. God didn't say, pick up your unan. He said, pick up your cross, okay? Your cross. Crosses are painful. Crosses hurt. Crosses involve death. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. But no one took His life. He laid it down willingly. How do we know this? Well, Jesus said so Himself. Look, in Matthew 26, do you remember when Peter grabbed a sword and chopped off Malchus's ear and Jesus had to heal his ear and all this trouble was going on while they were trying to arrest Jesus? What did Jesus say? Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father? Then He will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels. That's 72,000. A legion is 6,000. Now, that was a high number in those days. If we were to do this in modern terminology, you're talking about millions, okay? But they didn't have a number for million back then, okay? So you have to understand this back in its context. Jesus is basically saying, don't you think I could command a billion angels to come to my rescue? But I don't. I don't do that. Why? Because if I did, how then will the scriptures be fulfilled? What scriptures? We're reading it. Isaiah 53. That's the scripture. Psalm 22, if you want another in-depth look at the cross. Prophecies made centuries before Jesus came into the world. How then will the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen this way? What was Jesus saying? I willingly lay down my life. I'm your substitute. This is incredible. The rabbis want to say that this is speaking about Israel. I have never yet seen Israel willingly suffer. I certainly haven't seen them silently suffer. I certainly haven't seen them vicariously suffer. This does not talk about Israel. This is talking about Jesus. Jesus came and he died for Israel and for anyone else who will put their trust in him. He was oppressed, he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Led like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. In New Zealand and Australia, they have a sheep called a Judas sheep. Did you know that? It's the sheep that they send out first that all the other dumb sheep follow, okay? It's called a Judas sheep. And when they want to lead them to slaughter so that you can have your delicious lamb chops, what do? They send out the Judas sheep, and of course, all the other dumb sheep just kind of follow. And then they kill them. They put them to death. This is what happened to Jesus. Only he had a real Judas. A Judas who betrayed him into the hands of the authorities. What happened? He was taken before the leaders, and he was put on trial. But he remained silent in his trial. He said nothing. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. But what does it say? He did not open his mouth. That doesn't mean he didn't say anything. It means he did not fight back. He did not claim his rights. He didn't say, I'm an American citizen and I know my rights, okay? He didn't say that. He willingly went to his death. When the authorities asked him questions, he respectfully answered. But he never defended himself. He never tried to change their mind. He never tried to change the direction of the proceedings. He went silently through the trial without complaint. In verse 8, by oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered? That means there was nobody around that stood up for him. Nobody. Even his disciples. Now that was another fulfillment of prophecy, right? Do you remember the other prophecy? The shepherd will be struck and the sheep will what? Scatter. Another prophecy fulfilled. He was left all alone to face his death. Amazing. Now John turned up later with Mary and a few others. But initially, no one came to his defense, did they? He was there, all alone. And then it says that he was cut off out of the land of the living. What does that mean? It means he died. It means he was put to death. For the transgression of my people to whom the stroke was due. What does that mean? It means for the sins of the world, us who deserved to die because we are sinners. You and I should have been there. We deserved to hang on that cross. We should have taken the beating. We should have been crucified and we should have gone to hell. But he died in our place. Incredible. There's an old song we used to sing in England. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. It's what we call the cross, Calvary. What a gap. Our sin, he paid for it. He died in our place, and he was silent in his death. Did he complain? Did he ever complain once? The answer is no. Did he ever try to change their mind? No. Did he call on the angels to get him down? No. Instead, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Amazing. He said, they don't understand. They don't get it. And that's exactly what Israel is saying. We didn't get it. We didn't understand. We didn't know. I wonder how many people here this morning could say the same thing. We never understood. We didn't realize. We didn't know that we were sinners by nature. We didn't know that none of these religious things that we do would help. We didn't know that we needed a Savior. And finally, his grave was assigned with wicked men. Yet he was with a rich man in his death. Because he had done no violence, that means any external sin, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. There was nothing within him or outside of him that would have made you think that he was in any way a sinner. He was the sinless Son of God. Yet he went to his burial silent. He could have ended it, right? He could have said, that's enough. I'm not putting up with this anymore. I'm done with you people. But he didn't do that. He allowed them to kill him. And then he allowed them to bury him. Here, the sinless Son of God willingly suffers the wrath of a holy God, paying our sin debt in full by offering himself as a sacrifice for our sin. We have a debt. We have offended a holy God with our sin. We need a Savior. And God sent his Son. Let me pull that verse up again. I want to just point out one thing. His grave was assigned with wicked men, yet he was with a rich man in his death. I didn't think about this too much before, but I was reading somebody yesterday and they pointed it out and I thought, man, that is an amazing point. What did God do? They wanted to throw him away, right? You know what they used to do with criminals? They used to let their bodies rot and then they used to throw them into the Valley of Hinnom, which Jesus used to use as a picture of hell, where the fires never go out. And his rotting body would have been just tossed into that valley, into the fires. And that would be the end of it. But God didn't let that happen. He raised up who? What was the name of the guy? Joseph of Arimathea, right? He raised up Joseph of Arimathea, who was a rich man. He had a brand spanking new tomb. And he went and petitioned for Jesus' body and said, hey, can I please bury him in my tomb? And they let him. And he took Jesus to his tomb. Why is that important? Because the price was already paid, folks. What did Jesus say on the cross? It is finished. God's wrath had already been spent on Christ. There was nothing left to do. And God would not allow his Son to endure any more humiliation. Isn't that a good point? I'd not thought about that before until I read that guy. And he said that. He said, God wouldn't allow it. The price is paid. Sin has been atoned for. Why allow him to suffer any more humiliation? And God said, he will not be buried with the wicked. He will be buried with the rich. Why? Because he is rich. He's God. King of kings and Lord of lords. And finally, his suffering was saving. Another new word for you there. Efficacious. Efficacious means it achieved God's desired result. That's what it means. That's why we sometimes talk about efficacious grace. It means it's saving grace. Two kinds of grace in the world, common and saving. Common grace is what every person ever born on the earth enjoys. Another breath, their wedding day, a newborn baby, a sunset, a bowl of hallow hallow. That's all common grace, right? We all enjoy it. But saving grace, that only comes to those who repent of their sin and place their faith in Jesus Christ alone for their salvation. His death was a tragedy, a gross perversion of justice. But the final stanza of this song tells us God was pleased? What does that mean? God is pleased by this? It says in Ezekiel that the death of the wicked doesn't please God. He hates it. So if he hates the death of the wicked, how can he be pleased by the death of the righteous, his own son? It doesn't make sense. Until you realize at the cross we see men at their very worst. Their sin revealed like never before. How could man crucify Jesus Christ? He never did anything wrong to anyone. He never hurt anyone. He offered himself as a sacrifice, and men were willing to put him to death. That's awful. But at the same time, At the cross, we see God's finest hour. His glory on full display. Every one of his attributes, every one of his perfections kissing each other. We see his holiness. We see his righteousness. We see his justice. We see his wrath and his fury against sin at the cross. But we also see his mercy and his grace and his love towards sinners. Never was God more clearly seen than at the cross. Never. Amazing. God delighted in the purpose, not the pain. God delighted in the achievement of the cross, not the agony. God delighted in the salvation that his death bought, not the suffering he endured. God didn't want to hurt his son. That was not his desire. But what God would get out of it was infinitely worth it. What does God get out of it? Well, his glory for one, and you and me for the other. Do you really think we're worth it? I don't think so. That's why it's called grace. Because we're really not. We live a selfish lives. We go our own way. We betray him. We sin against him. And yet he sends his son to die in our place. That's what Easter is all about. In verse 10 it says, "But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief if he would render himself as a guilt offering." That's the fifth of the five offerings I told you about. Only three of those offerings pay for sin. That's the burnt offering, the sin offering, and the guilt offering. And with the guilt offering, the whole animal goes on the fire. Okay? Complete atonement for sin. The whole animal. It was the daily sacrifice every morning and every evening, 9 a.m. and 3 p.m., the Jews would offer the guilt offering, sometimes known as the trespass offering. He offered himself. He threw himself on the fire so that our sin could be paid for. And then it says something remarkable. Even though he's dead, even though he's been cut off out of the land of the living, even though he's offered himself as a guilt offering, he will see his offspring. What does that mean? He will prolong his days. How's that possible? He's dead. And the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. How can anything prosper in the hands of someone who is dead? Well, we know the answer, don't we? Because the righteous one is also the risen one. And that's what we're here to celebrate today. So how do we answer this question? How could a holy and just God forgive sinners that deserve hell, declare them righteous, allow them to enter heaven, and still remain holy and just? That's the question Paul asks in Romans chapter 3. How is this possible? Well, he tells you in the final two verses. As a result of the anguish of his, that is Jesus' soul, he, that is God, will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will what? Justify the many. The word justify means to be proclaimed righteous. God declares you legally right with him, even though you don't deserve it, because of what Jesus did on your behalf, as he will bear their iniquities. Now notice, it's all changed again. This isn't Israel anymore. Now we're looking at God. These are singular pronouns, and we're looking at a future tense. He will, not he did. And we're back to God again. We started with God. We listened to Israel's confession of sin and repentance. And now we're listening to God's final word on the cross. What is it? God says, "As a holy God, I am completely satisfied with his death." Remember, he's been offended. God is the offended party. Jesus wasn't punished by Satan at the cross. Jesus wasn't even punished by sinners at the cross. Jesus was punished by his Father at the cross. That's what happened. He was punished for our sin. He didn't die a martyr's death, folks. There was no grace upholding him through the trial. The Holy Spirit wasn't lending him assistance, as far as we can tell. Martyrs die with songs on their lips, joy in their hearts, because God upholds them But he died under the full weight, the terror of the law for us. No comfort. None. So that we could go free. And God says, I am completely satisfied. That's why it says in Romans 8, who will bring a charge to God's elect? Who can? No one. Because he's been satisfied, right? God was satisfied with Christ's death. Sin has been completely atoned for, and sinners can be made completely righteous. Therefore, he says in the last verse, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong. Who are the strong? Who's he going to divide the booty with? Who do you think? Any ideas? What does Romans 8 say? We are heirs of God and co-heirs with who? Jesus Christ. We are the strong. We are the ones who have put our trust in him and have been declared right with God. We are the ones who will share the inheritance with him. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. He will inherit everything. That's the whole point of the book of Revelation. That the kingdom of this world becomes the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. That's the whole point. But he's not going to keep it all to himself. Those that put their trust in him will share the booty with him. Why? Because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he himself bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors. His humiliation is over. His exaltation and his mediation has begun. That word intercession there means literally mediation. A lot of people in the Philippines put their trust in a lot of different mediators, right? But the Bible says there's only one. 1 Timothy 2 says there's only one mediator between God and man, and that's Jesus Christ. And here his humiliation ends, and he is exalted to the highest place. And you know what he's doing right now? He is mediating for us before the very throne of God. Isn't that incredible? But that's what the Bible says. The Lamb of God has been slain. The final sacrifice for sin has been made. The work of salvation is complete. God's justice and wrath has been satisfied. There is nothing left to be done. Nothing. Nothing. Nothing you do will ever contribute to what Christ has done. You need to understand that. It's an offense to God that you even try. What sin does God hate the most? Oh, not all sins are equal. Don't believe Facebook, okay? The Bible doesn't say anything like that. There are sins God hates more than others. You realize that? What sin does he hate? He hates what? Self-righteousness. He hates it. He despises self-righteousness. Whenever he interacted with the Pharisees, it was a war, wasn't it? He attacked them, and they attacked him back. Why did he attack them? Because they were self-righteous. Because they thought they could save themselves. When the Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 3 gives an account of his life, what does he say? Everything I used to trust in, all the religious ceremonies, all the sacrifices, all the washings, everything I did for God, to me, it is now what? Dung, manure. That's what he says. Do you know why? Because when he met Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus, and he was struck down blind on that road, Jesus said something to him. Do you remember what it was? Why are you persecuting me? Now, Paul thought he was religious. Paul thought he was doing good works. Paul thought he was doing religious ceremonies. Paul had Abraham to mediate in his corner. Paul had Moses to speak on his behalf. Guess what? What did Jesus say it was? Why are you persecuting me? And Paul says, that moment, there was only one question I had left to ask. What do you want me to do, Lord? That was his response. Who are you? I'm Jesus, the one you're persecuting. What do you want me to do? Two questions. Amazing. He is risen, folks. He is no longer dead. That was always God's plan. God engineered the whole thing from beginning to start. His death and his resurrection was planned before the world was even made. It's incredible. And the Bible says in Romans 10, if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord, that means God, folks. You need to understand that. The word Lord in the New Testament, kurios, okay? That is the word translated back into the Greek Old Testament as the word Yahweh. Do you understand that? When you call him Lord, when the early Christians said Jesus is Lord, that was their main statement of faith. Jesus is Lord. You know what they were saying? Jesus is God. That's what they believed. If you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Friends, this is the only provision that God has made for salvation. Hebrews 10 tells you that if you refuse this salvation, there is no other sacrifice. God has made no other way. There is only one way to God. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father. No one goes to heaven. No one enters my kingdom unless they come through me. As we close, I'm going to put up a little prayer. I want you to understand something, though. I don't normally do this. People can misunderstand prayers. This is not a magic prayer, okay? No such thing. What this is just a way for maybe some of you to articulate what's going on in your heart right now. Maybe God has been speaking to you. Maybe you felt the weight of your sin as you looked upon the sacrifice that Jesus has made. We trust that maybe the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you, that he showed you how sinful you are, that he's shown you how righteous and holy God is, and that you will one day be judged for your sin. And if you're in that place this morning, I invite you to pray this prayer with me, not because it's a magic prayer, okay, but just to help you find a way to articulate what might be going on in your heart. Dear Father in heaven, I want to thank you for loving me so much that you are willing to judge, punish, and sacrifice your own son for my sin. I believe that I am a sinner and that your son suffered and died in my place for my sin. I know that I can never earn your forgiveness, and I place all my trust in the sacrifice you provided for me, the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, I'm asking you to save me. Make me one of your disciples and take your rightful place as Lord of my life. As we continue our journey together, I pray that you will teach me how to live a life that is pleasing to you so that others may come to know you as well. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and you meant it, I'd really like to invite you to come to the Connect Room after the service, because it's good for you to meet other Christians. It's good for you to be prayed with. It's good for us to maybe answer any questions that you might have. We would love to meet you. We would love to help you. So please take advantage of that. Let somebody know if you gave your life to the Lord today, if he saved you. It's important for your well-being, okay? So thank you all. Have a great day.